Salam students, let's begin with the class 8 history, chapter 3, ruling the countryside. The fourth part of this chapter we are doing today. Now, you all know very well about the content. The company becomes the Diwan. We have completed crops for Europe. And today we are going to deal with the main, that Blue Rebellion and after. Just let's see what are the topics that we have covered in the company becomes the Diwan. From the beginning, we have seen about the revenue for the company, the need to improve agriculture. In that, we learned about the permanent settlement, then the problem faced by the permanent settlement, then again the new system, that was Mahalwari system, was devised, then Munro system, that was also called as Rayothwari system. We have learned that again that was not well, all was not well in that. Then the next topic, we saw that the crops for Europe, cultivation of opium and indigo, right? Then we saw, does color have a history? Then the next topic, why the demand for Indian indigo increased? In that, we saw the European countries, they tried with another alternative also, that is with the vote plan. But then that was not satisfactory for them. Then we saw the Britain turns towards our country, India, right? Then in our last session, we learnt about how was indigo cultivated. Indigo was cultivated with two main systems, that were niche cultivation and Rayothi system, right? We have learnt about that. But what did we see in the niche cultivation? It was a planter. The planter produced indigo in lands that he directly controlled, or he either bought the land or rented it from other zamindars and produced indigo by directly employing the hired laborers, right? But again, there was a problem. What was the problem here? The planters found it difficult to expand the area under niche cultivation because the land required for indigo should be fertile land, and these areas were densely populated. So only the small plots can be acquired for indigo plantation. So this was the problem that we have learned. Then we saw indigo on the land of Rayots. That is, in that we learnt about the Rayothi system. Under the Rayothi system, the planters forced the Rayots to sign a contract, an agreement. And that is also, agreement is also called as Satta, right? In that, it was like the loan committed the Rayot to cultivate indigo on at least 25% of his holding. Of the holding of his land. So 25% was to be utilized only for indigo plantation. Then we saw the method, how was indigo produced, right? Now the next topic that we are going to see here, the Blue Rebellion and after. See, we saw in our last session the problems that were faced by the indigo cultivators, correct? That the problems, what did we see? The planters usually that insisted that indigo to be cultivated on best soil, right? It should be cultivated only on the fertile soil, whereas they were using that land for the rice cultivation also. So the quality of the land was not so perfect for the indigo plantation because the rice cultivation was also turned on that simultaneously. And we saw one more problem, the problem of that loan cycle. And the price they got for the indigo that they produced, that was very low. That was also there. But apart from that, the cycle of loan, what was that cycle? Once the crop was delivered to the planter after the harvest, a new loan was given to the rot again. And this cycle goes on continuously. So indigo cultivators, they understood, they have got stuck up in that cycle. It is not difficult for them to come out of it. Then finally, what happened? They got exhausted. And so finally, the Blue Rebellion. See, when the rebellion starts, when the problem goes to that high extent where the person cannot go against it, definitely then people have to revolt against it. That is called as the Blue Rebellion. So in March 1859, thousands of Rayots. Rayots means, I hope you all know very well here, the farmers and cultivators in Bengal. They refused to grow indigo. Then that was only called as, they even attacked the indigo factories. This was known as the Blue Rebellion. What they did, as the rebellion spread, the Rayots refused to pay the rents to the planters and they attacked indigo factories armed with swords and spears, bows and arrows. Then women also, even women joined with them. The women turned up to fight with pots, pans and the kitchen implements. Now children, you can imagine how would this Blue Rebellion would have taken place, right? Those who worked for the planters were socially boycotted. And they were called as Gomashtas, that is, they were known as the agents of the planters, and who came to collect rent, they were beaten up by the indigo cultivators. And even Riot swore that they would no longer take advances to sow indigo, nor be bullied by the planters. Lathials, now here the meaning of Lathials have been given to you. The lathi wielding strongman, wielding means holding, maintained by the planters. So they were opposing even the Gomashtas and the Lathials also, those who were working with the planters. Who were opposing them? Indigo cultivators. But why did the indigo peasants decided that they would no longer remain silent? What gave them the power to rebel? Now, the indigo system, we all know that very well. It was intensely oppressive, right? But those who are oppressed do not always rise up in rebellion. They do so only at times. So in 1859, what happened? The indigo rats felt that they had the support of the local zamindars and the village headmen in the rebellion against the planters. So in many villages, headmen who had been forced to sign indigo contracts mobilized indigo peasants and fought pitched battles with the Lathials. So they were having the battle with the Lathials and the Gomashtas also. In other places, even the zamindars went around villages urging the riots to resist the planters. So these zamindars were unhappy with the increasing power of the planters and angry at being forced by the planters to give them land on long leases. So, but what that indigo peasants, they imagined that the British government would support them in their struggle against the planters. Now here the image of that struggle, the Blue Rebellion, has been given to you. So after the revolt of 1857, the British government was particularly worried about the possibility of another popular rebellion. So when the news spread of a simmering revolt in the Indigo district, the Lieutenant Governor General toured the region in the winter of 1859. Then what did that Lieutenant General saw? The Riots saw the tour as a sign of government sympathy for their plight. So Riots understood too, they took it in the positive way. When in Barasat, the magistrate Ashley Eden, the image has been given here, issued a notice stating that Riots would not be compelled to accept indigo contracts. Word went around that Queen Victoria had declared that indigo need not be sown. So even Eden was trying to placate means pacify the peasants and control an explosive situation. But his action was read as support for the rebellion. So it was considered like even the British government was supporting the riots in that way. It has been suggested in that way. So as the rebellion spread, intellectuals from Calcutta rushed to the Indigo district. They wrote of the misery of the riots. They wrote about the horrors of the indigo system. Then after that, worried by the rebellion, the government brought in the military to protect the planters from assault and set up the Indigo Commission to inquire into the system of indigo production. Now what that commission tells us, the commission held the planters guilty and criticized them for their coercive method. Coercive means like you can say the methods that has been used with force or with threat. They were using against the indigo cultivators. And it declared that indigo production was not at all profitable for the riots. So the commission asked the riots to fulfill their... What did the commission put forward in front of the riots? They told them, see, whatever the existing contracts you all have, complete that one at least. Don't leave them. But henceforth in the future, they told them that they could refuse to produce indigo in future. So this is what the commission... Indigo Commission gave one of the pointers, but the existing contract should not be the sufferer. So that's why they told them at least complete that one. And the remaining ones, whatever you will get in the future, you can refuse it. So what happened after the revolt? Indigo production collapsed in Bengal. But then it was shifted that the same operation, the planters now shifted their operation towards Bihar. With the discovery of synthetic dyes in the late 19th century, their business was severely affected. But they managed to expand production. When Mahatma Gandhi returned from South Africa, a peasant from Bihar persuaded him to visit Champaran and see the plight of the indigo cultivators there. So Mahatma Gandhi's visit in 1917 marked the beginning of the Champaran movement against the indigo planters. So this is what how the Blue Rebellion has been taken place. So in that Blue Rebellion, we saw the Queen Victoria. She declared that indigo need not be sown by them, by the indigo cultivators. So even the intellectuals from Calcutta, they also supported them by writing about that misery of the riots, correct? Then finally, the government brought in the military to protect the planters. And then the Indigo Commission was set up, declaring some points related to that, what is to be done, that the Indigo Commission gave. The planters were guilty, that is what the commission said. But then they also criticized them for their methods that they were using to against the indigo cultivators. Then finally it was like the commission asked the riots also to fulfill their existing contracts, but they can refuse the indigo production in future. This is what we learned in the Blue Rebellion. So here today we have learned about the Blue Rebellion. Let's have the quick recap of what we have learned in today's session. Now, in March 1859, right, the riots in Bengal, what did they do? They refused to cultivate indigo and they refused to pay rents to planters. They even attacked the indigo factories. This was known as the Blue Rebellion, correct? Then they were the agents of planters, that was called as the Gomastas, who collected the rent on their behalf. Even they were beaten up by the indigo cultivators. Even Lathials, those who were the lathi-wielding strongmen, maintained by the planters. So they started opposing many indigo cultivators. They refused to cultivate indigo for the British, correct? This is what we saw in the Blue Rebellion. Then what prompted them? The indigo plantation system was very oppressive, right, for the cultivators as well as for the local headmen. So in 1859, riots felt that they had the support of the local zamindars against the planters. So they decided, like, these zamindars were also unhappy with increasing power of the planters. That gave them the provokeness of this Blue Rebellion. Then after the revolt of 1857, what, the government was worried about the possibility of another revolt. That is due to the news of discontent of the riots. The Lieutenant General toured the region in 1859, right? Then Magistrate Ashley Eden in Barasat issued a notice stating that riots would not be forced to sign indigo contracts, correct? Even Queen Victoria, she gave the approval on that. Then what happened? Then worried by the rebellion, the government set up the Indigo Commission. It was to inquire that the system of indigo production. It held the planters guilty and also they were criticized for their coercive method that they were using. And it declared that the system as non-profitable for riots, correct? They were told to fulfill the existing contracts. This is what government told them through a commission to indigo cultivators to fulfill the existing contracts and allowed them to refuse to produce the indigo in future, correct? Then we saw the government, after setting up the indigo cultivation, then we saw what happened. The planters now shifted their operation from Bengal towards the Bihar. Then with the discovery of synthetic dyes in the late 19th century, their business was also severely affected. Even then, they managed to increase production. So on the return of Mahatma Gandhi from South Africa, a peasant from Bihar persuaded him to visit Champaran. He requested him to see the plight of the indigo cultivators there, correct? Then Mahatma Gandhi's visit in 1917, that was marked as the beginning of the Champaran movement against the indigo cultivators. So this is what today we have come to an end of the chapter. That is, whatever we have learned from the beginning, initially you learnt about the strategies, the different devices, the different policies that the Britishers were adopting. We learnt about the permanent settlement, we learnt about the Mahalwari system, we learnt about the Rohtwari system. Then we saw the company changed focus towards the crops for Europe, right? They started the cultivation of opium and indigo, correct? Then we saw the problems again in the indigo cultivation also. The two systems we learnt in our last session, niche cultivation and Rewati system, the problems faced under that cultivation. Then after that, we saw how the indigo was produced. Then again, today, after going all through this, we saw the rebellion that the indigo cultivators did against the company. And finally, the people of the indigo cultivators of the Bengal, they got the relief from that in that way. So here we have completed with our chapter, Ruling the Countryside, today. See you in the next session with a new chapter. Till then, take care.